Thank you very much. As already announced, my name is Petra Redberg. I'm working at the German Aerospace Center DLR here in Cologne. And the data I would like to present to you about our work on radiation and desiccation resistance of hyperthermophiles were obtained in close cooperation with many colleagues from the University of Regensburg. So as we have heard in the previous talk, the relationship between all living organisms on Earth can be shown in a kind of phylogenetic tree, where closely related organisms are close to each other on different branches on a tree, and those which are not closely related are more distantly placed on such a tree. And today's phylogenetic trees are based on the comparison of DNA sequences of conservative genes. Helga already mentioned trees based on 16S rRNA gene. And today we have three domains of organisms, two domains of organisms without a nucleus called prokaryotes. These are the bacteria and the archaea. And another domain of organisms which have a nucleus, the so-called eukaryotes. In this picture, you can see a more detailed phylogenetic tree with the different branches of the bacteria, eukarya, and archaea. We are interested in hyperthermophilic organisms, and these are shown here on the sketch in bold, and they are found close to the root of the phylogenetic tree. So this might also give us some hints about the origin of life on Earth. The question is if the tree of life can tell us something about the origin of life on Earth and the environmental conditions at that time. And some people formulated the hypothesis that LUCA, the last universal common ancestor, might have evolved in a hot environment because of these findings I've mentioned just before. However, other groups of scientists developed alternative hypotheses. They looked at different genes, not only at 16S rRNA genes, and they compared conservative proteins and made some different assumptions, and they suggested that the last universal common ancestor was mesophilic, that the thermotolerance increased later on, that the ancestors of bacteria and archaea eukarya convergently adapted to high temperatures, and that later on the thermotolerance decreased again as we have it today on Earth. So there are different arguments for both points of view. There's a lot of research which has to be done in the future about this. What are thermophiles or hyperthermophiles? Thermophiles are organisms which are able to grow at temperatures between 45 degrees centigrade and plus 80 degrees centigrade. Hyperthermophiles grow at higher temperatures than 80 degrees centigrade. In our group, we looked at several different species of hyperthermophilic archaea and deep-branching bacteria. In addition, we also looked in some cases at closely related mesophilic species to try to find out what the difference between those and the hyperthermophiles are. What is typical for hyperthermophiles? They are not only adapted to growth at very high temperatures, but many of them are also able to grow at extreme pH values, for example, very acidic conditions at low pH values. Many of them are also grow at very high soil concentrations or even require high soil concentrations. Many of them are growing under anoxic conditions, and also others are also chemolithoautotrophic, meaning they do not need organic compounds for the synthesis of biomass. Therefore, these thermophiles and hyperthermophiles are of astrobiological interest, and we would like to know if they could survive in space or on other planets and moons of our solar system, because this is interesting for our future search for life on planetary bodies and also for what we call planetary protection. This is a set of measures because we do not want to send spacecraft to other planets and moons to search for life and contaminate unwantedly these celestial bodies by terrestrial life forms, which might grow or at least survive on these planetary bodies. We started our investigations by looking at the survivability of hyperthermophiles under extreme conditions like desiccation and radiation. Desiccation or desiccating conditions can have very different effects on the different cellular components. One effect is a change in the conformation of the DNA. If we delete the water in cells, the DNA structure changes from the B conformation to the A conformation. And this can have severe consequences for the whole cell. In addition, desiccation induces DNA damage, for example, single strand breaks and double strand breaks, but also enables the formation of DNA protein crosslinks. Desiccation can result in protein denaturation, disturbing the structure of proteins, which then will not be able any longer to perform the normal functions. And in addition, membrane damages can be induced under desiccating conditions in all cells. We started our desiccation experiments by growing the different species we are interested in under their normal growth conditions. We determined the cell density, spread, for example, 10 to the 7 cells on glass fiber filters or slides, and exposed them to desiccation conditions for different periods of time. We tested desiccation at plus or minus 20 degrees centigrade and at minus 80 degrees centigrade. We looked at the effect of different pH values. We tested pH 2 and 5. We cultivated the organisms on different substrates like sulfur or pyrite, and we did this experiment either in the presence or absence of oxygen. After these periods of desiccation, we reactivated our samples by putting them back into their specific growth medium. We performed dilution series, incubated them under their conditions, and determined the survival rates by these dilution series. Because almost all of these organisms cannot be grown on solid surfaces like agarfates, and therefore it's not possible to do the normal colony counting assay. You can see an overview of our results. On the left side in this table, you can see the different species of archaea we have investigated, and on the right side, some thermophilic bacteria. And it turned out that 17 of the 32 tested species are tolerant at least to a certain degree against desiccation. A plus means at least one cell survived after one day of desiccation under the given conditions. A minus stands for no growth in this table. And this finding was quite surprising for us because almost all of these organisms come from aquatic habitats and they are usually never exposed to desiccating conditions. We looked at the desiccation tolerance in more detail with several species. Here you can see the results. This is a surviving ratio of a population exposed to desiccating conditions. These are the untreated samples, and these are the ones desiccated in the absence of oxygen and here in the presence of oxygen. Please see that the x-axis is quite different in the different graphs for these species shown here. You can see a strong influence on the presence or absence of oxygen. Some organisms only survive desiccation conditions for a certain period of time under anoxic conditions. Others survive also under oxic conditions. The desiccation tolerance is quite different. The record holder in our experiments is a bacterium called Hydrogenothermus marinus, which survived up to 196 days of desiccation under the chosen conditions. But the experimental conditions have a strong influence on the desiccation tolerance, for example, the temperature. At minus 20 degree, the desiccation tolerance was found to be higher than at room temperature. The pH is also important in this case for Lophiolobus metallicus. The tolerance was higher at pH 5 than at pH 2. But also the substrate on which these organisms were cultivated before these experiments is important. If, for example, Metallosphera zedula was cultivated on ore, the desiccation tolerance was higher than if it was cultivated on elementary sulfur. So we can say that desiccation tolerance is a common phenomenon amongst hypothermophilic bacteria and archaea. This was quite new at the time. It turned out to be highly species specific. We found big differences between organisms from the same order or even from the same genus, for example, Sophilobus and Methanosacina. And the desiccation tolerance varies between hours and months. It's influenced by several experimental parameters, like storage time, storage temperature, pH, oxygen, substrates available, relative humidity, and vacuum. Coming to radiation, here you can see the electromagnetic spectrum with visible light in this part with wavelengths from 400 to 750 nanometer. At higher energies, we find the ultraviolet radiation. And at even higher energies, we find X-ray. Ultraviolet radiation or UV radiation is non-ionizing, whereas X-rays are ionizing, meaning this radiation can form, can break covalent bonds in complex molecules. Radiation interacts with matter through different processes, either ionizing radiation or excitation. And there are two alternative ways radiation damage can occur in biological objects, especially in proteins, RNA, and DNA. Either the DNA is absorbed directly, then we have the direct radiation effect, for example, the formation of pyrimidine dimers after UV exposure of DNA, or we have the interaction of radiation and the formation of radicals. This is called the indirect radiation effect. Examples are oxidized DNA bases after exposure of DNA to ionizing radiation. In addition to the two mentioned types of damage, both types of radiation can also induce a whole variety of other damages in DNA, like abasic sites, single and double strand breaks, the formation of adducts, but also DNA and protein crosslinks. And all these damages have to be repaired in cells before replication. Otherwise, mutations which can be harmful might be induced in the cells, or the cells might die. Therefore, DNA damages are very severe and have to be repaired. In our experiments, as before, we determine the cell density and expose different hypothermophilic organisms to UV radiation. We have chosen for this experiment a UVC radiation of 254 nanometer, because this is close to the maximum of the biological efficiency of UV radiation on DNA. We exposed our organisms either in suspension under anoxic conditions in non-absorbing liquid media, or we exposed our organisms on desiccated on glass slides after drying. We have chosen a whole variety of different fluences, ranging from very low fluences, like 10 joules per square meter, up to 5,000 joules per square meter. After exposure to radiation, we performed dilution series to measure the survival rate, as we have done it before in the desiccation experiment. For ionizing radiation exposures, we did the experiment in suspension under anoxic conditions, either with X-rays in an X-ray machine with a dose rate of 20 gray per minute for doses up to 5 kilogray, or use the cobalt 60 gamma source with a dose rate of 170 gray per minute and doses up to 20 kilogray. You can see an overview of the results after exposure of our organisms to UVC radiation. again, on the left, in the left table, you can see the hyperfilmophilic archaea, on the right side, the bacteria. And we found out that 17 of the tested species are at least resistant to low fluences of UVC radiation, but we could see no correlation between desiccation tolerance, shown here, and UVC radiation resistance, shown here. This is interesting because many years ago, scientists stated that both tolerance or resistances are connected. This was an hypothesis formulated first for a very radiation-resistant bacterium called Deinococcus spiroduans. And some groups think that the radiation resistance of this bacterium is a consequence of the desiccation resistance. But this seems not to be the general case, as we have seen here with these many species we have investigated under these conditions. If we look into more details and if we look for fluent survival curves, you can see here a graph showing these curves, the relative survival as a function of UVC fluence. In addition to the hyperthermophiles we have investigated in our study, we also did some experiments with a very radiation resistant Deinococcus spiroduans, shown here, and the quite or more or less UV radiation sensitive bacterium Bacillus subtilis. This is a bacterium which is very which is used very often as a model system in astrobiological space experiments. It can be used in or tested in two different forms, either as vegetative cells, which are able to multiply immediately, which are quite sensitive to UV radiation, but it can also be there in the form of spores, which are resting states of these bacteria, which are a bit more resistant than the vegetative cells. The hyperthermophiles we look at are between those sensitive or very resistant other microorganisms, and the survival rates are more or less in the same order of magnitude for the strains we have tested here. When we look at the effect of a combined treatment of desiccation and UV radiation, we can see that in the example of Archaeoglobus fulvidus and Hydrogenotermus marinus, we can see that a combination of both factors leads to a sensitization at low fluences. When we add ore as shielding material to the bacterial suspensions, we could show that they protect efficiently against the effects of UVC radiation as to be expected, but that the addition of ore in this case does not lead to changes in the tolerance against desiccation. Coming to ionizing radiation, here you can see the dose survival curves for experiments up to 20 kilograms. And of the 15 species we have tested, nine of them survived at least 5 kilogray, and two of them, namely Apiphex chlorophyllus and Apiphex hospitalis, survived 20 kilogray. We compared these values, or the radiation resistance of these organisms, shown here as the D10 values, that is the dose where 10% of a given population survives treatment, to literature data or to own data, again, to Bacillus subtilis, but also to other species. And we can say that these two quite radiation-resistant organisms belong to the high radiation-resistant organisms, but there are others which are more resistant, like Deinococcus or Halobacterium or Thermococcus. To summarize this part, concerning UV radiation, survival rates range within the same order of magnitude of about 10 to the minus 3 to 10 to the minus 4 after an exposure to 1,000 joules per square meter UVC. Concerning ionizing radiation resistant, two species, Apiphex chlorophyllus and Ignifocus hospitalis, are highly resistant and survive even 20 kilogray. And, quite remarkable, desiccation tolerance and radiation resistance is not correlated. Later on, we started to look at compatible solutes, which were already mentioned in the presentation before. These are small soluble molecules belonging to different chemical classes, substances, for example, polyols, carbohydrates, or amino acids, the molecular interactions in the cell are still partly unknown. These compatible solutes bind to proteins instead of water and help to stabilize the conformation of proteins by this binding. And the high intracellular concentration leads to a water retention in cells. It is known that they function as osmoprotectants, and in hyperthermophiles, they also function as thermoprotectants. The synthesis of these small molecules can be induced by higher salt concentrations in the growth medium or by higher temperatures than under optimal conditions. We asked the question if compatible solutes can protect hyperthermophiles against other deleterious environmental factors like desiccation. For this, we cultivated different hyperthermophiles under their specific conditions, but either with higher soil concentrations or higher temperature. We desiccated them under oxic or anoxic conditions at room temperature. After certain periods of desiccation, we reactivated them again, as we did this in the other experiments before, and we measured survival and growth via the dilution series. The identification and quantification of the compatible solute was done by our colleague Erwin Galinski from the University of Bonn, and he used C13 NMR, HPLC, and ICP measurements to identify and quantify these substances. Here you can see the results for Archaeoglobus fulvidus. There was a really surprising increase in desiccation tolerance if these cells contain compatible solutes. You'll see the results for samples without desiccation. Here, desiccation under anoxic conditions after the induction of the synthesis of compatible solutes, and here the same under oxic conditions compared to cells cultivated under normal conditions without the induction of compatible solutes in the anoxic and oxic conditions. And from this experiment, we can see that the increase in survival compared to standard conditions is about 2 to 3 orders of magnitude only by these compatible solutes. And not only after a short period of desiccation, but also after long periods of desiccation. In this graph, some results of Hydrogenocanthus marinus are shown. Again, here are the results for desiccation without desiccation, compared to desiccation tolerance under normal standard conditions, in this case 2% salt. Then the desiccation tolerance increases up to concentrations of 4% salt and then decreases again. The compatible solutes were identified and turned out to be D-glycerol phosphate in the case of Archaeoglobus and monosyl glycerate in the case of Hydrogenocanthus. In both cases, potassium ions were found to be the counter ions to this negatively charged compatible solutes in the cells. So to summarize this part, salt can induce the synthesis of compatible solutes in the investigated hyperthermophilic microorganisms. The presence of compatible solutes has an impact on desiccation tolerance of both species, Archaeoglobus and Hydrogenocanthus. Potassium serves as counter ion. Some compatible solutes can protect the cells against severe damaging effects of desiccation. Therefore, they not only function as osmo and thermoprotectants, but also as desiccation protectants. What I did not show, we tried to find an effect of the induction of compatible solutes on radiation resistance, and we did not find any effect either with UV radiation or with ionizing radiation. For this, I would like to thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Yes, I would have some questions. This was a very, very interesting research. My question is, did you do any proteomic or genomic research? And if you did, these thermophile, extremophile functions can be found in all organisms as one dedicated gene, or it is different?
We are just starting with these assays you have mentioned before. One problem is that, first of all, some of these hypothermophiles are not easy to cultivate in the lab. Another problem is that many of them are not sequenced so far. And
yes.
To go more into detail, you need the information about the genome sequences. But some of them are sequenced, and many more will be sequenced in the near future. So what was this comment?
That will give a more convincing answer. So thank you very much. Thank you.
Yes, Petr, I would like to ask you, when you are doing cultures in these very stressful conditions, do you easily produce various mutants, or even do you kind of pick up tolerant?
Well, the problem is that these organisms cannot be grown on solid surfaces like agar plates. And for looking for mutations, you have to isolate single cells and cultivate them to get, as you do this with normal bacteria, to get clones of them to do this molecular analysis. Therefore, for all of them, we do not have any mutants because we cannot grow them on agar plates.
Okay, but then what's your opinion on whether you would easily produce different phenotypes just by growing bacteria in different conditions?
There are a few examples of systems to do molecular biology with some of these organisms, but so far these are only the exceptions. Normally we do not have yet genetic tools to work with these organisms. But for some of them, they are available, and I think there will be more in the future.
All right. I'm just kind of still pushing with the same question of whether, of course, it cannot be easily studied, but whether it would be possible that the microbes would adapt, for instance, to, say, Martian or planetary conditions.
Well, adaptation, which is fixed in the genetic material, requires a set of mutations which enable the microorganisms to survive better than their ancestors. And this can be approached in the lab by artificial evolutionary experiments, where you expose your culture to a certain environmental stressor and recultivate the survivors and do it again and again. And by these attempt, you can come up with new strains of a species which are adapted to the environmental conditions we have applied. With hypothermophiles, we did not do this type of experiment so far, but we did a similar experiment I just described with Bacillus subtilis, and we exposed these bacteria to Mars-like UV radiation climate for 69 cycles, and we came up with a new strain of Bacillus subtilis, which is more resistant to UV radiation and to ionizing radiation. But with this hypothermophiles, we didn't do this experiment so far. But in principle, it's possible. But it's helpful, of course, if you have the genome information to be able to interpret what has happened with these species.
Yes, thank you, Petra.
Yes, first of all, thank you, Petra, for the nice lecture. And we have a question by Mr. Damian Budne. I'm giving him the floor.
Yes, thank you. Actually, I have two questions. First is, how high is the possibility of contamination Mars or the Moon by terrestrial life coming from our space mission? And second, how can we be sure that the organism discovered by probes on Mars, on Moon, didn't come from Earth. Thank you.
Well, I would like to start with the second question. There's an international agreement to follow rules which describe what we call planetary protection. And these rules limit the maximal bioburden on spacecraft, for example, who are supposed to land on Mars. And this includes a lot of different measures. First of all, you have to make sure that you have a very low bioburden below a certain limit on your spacecraft, and you have to control it all the time. And this requires a lot of sterilization and cleaning steps when you build a spacecraft. And this is a very important thing which has to be taken into consideration when you even start to design a spacecraft. But these guidelines and limits are defined by COSPA. This is the Committee of Space Research, and COSPA has UN mandate to develop such a planet protection policy and to make sure that all spacefaring nations know this and agree to it and follow to it. For example, if you are sending a spacecraft to Mars, you are not allowed to have more than 5 × 10⁵ microbes on the surfaces exposed to the Martian environment. And there are different control steps and different measures to stay beneath this limit. Concerning the survival on Mars, the most deleterious environmental factor on the surface of Mars is the UV radiation, because on Mars we have a very thin atmosphere and we do not have oxygen in the atmosphere. Therefore, we do not have a protecting ozone layer. As a result, very short wavelengths from the sun, from UV radiation from the sun, can penetrate to the Martian surface, and this results in a very deleterious UV radiation climate on the surface of Mars. Therefore, all terrestrial microbes on the surface of Mars, which would be brought there by humans, would be destroyed in a very short time. However, if those microbes are not directly at the surface, but buried somehow in the Martian regolith, some of them might at least survive there for quite long periods of time, because many organisms are able to survive under these dry and cold conditions. But survival is not the same as growth, as already explained by Helga in the previous talk. For growth, much more requirements have to be fulfilled. You have to have liquid water, you have to have nutrients, and you have to have an energy source. Therefore, I think very few, if any, terrestrial organisms might be able to multiply on the surface of Mars. In the depth, it might be different.
Okay, thank you. And actually, maybe this question was addressed to both the speakers. So maybe if Helga is still there, maybe she can also answer or add some point, her point of view to this question. I don't know.
Well, I can just as a brief comment. There is salt on Mars, and there are probably salt deposits in the universe because some meteorites have come down to Earth. And so we were, of course, quite excited to see that there are salt crystals, there are fluid inclusions, and there are little particles in this salt. So that would be the positive note. Maybe there is some hint for halophilic life. But with survival, it's very similar to what Peter said. The UV radiation is very dangerous, and if the salt crystals are really coming from Earth to Mars, I think it's very unlikely. So these would be microorganisms which probably are not candidates to look at for planetary protection measures, but there are many others, of course.
Mm-hmm. So, thank you. I have a more technical question for Petra, and because maybe I didn't understand very well. So the point is, you have this method for studying cells that I forgot the word that requires the it's called. So the problem is that you have 10^7 cells, and then you have to dilute such solutions with cells. My question is how it is possible to make some statistics with 10 to 7 cells?
As I said, we cannot grow these organisms on agar plates. Therefore, we have chosen the method, the so-called most probable number methods, by diluting our samples and looking at the dilution step at which we find survival and the next one where we do not find any survival anymore. We, of course, start with cell counting under the microscope, and then we start to do this dilution series. It's a lot of work. We did everything at least in triplicates, and we repeated the experiments at least 2 to 3 times. And as you can imagine, if you have that many organisms, you have hundreds and thousands of samples you have to look at.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you very much. So I guess we don't have many more questions. Thank you. And I would like to thank you very much all the lecturers of today and send my greetings from Szczecin. Thanks a lot.
Okay. Hello, Petra. Thank you very much for your nice lesson and for very interesting results. I will show your lesson to the students on YouTube because today it was impossible to organize the lesson for the students. But I would like to ask you one question because you showed very interesting results showing that radiation resistance is not linked with desiccation resistance. And but I would like to ask you. I know that in some cases the radiation, the damage to the cell is due under radiation to the production of free radicals due to the to radiation. These free radicals are from water, and this can damage the cell. How can you interpret this fact that cells are more protected against radiation in water than desiccated?
Please, could you repeat your question?
I would like to know your interpretation about this fact that your cells are able to resist in hydrated condition better than in dehydrated condition, if I well understood your results.
The comparison between desiccated and cells in aqueous suspension were done only for UV radiation, and I think it was not a general phenomenon. Usually, if you talk about ionizing radiation, cells are more resistant in the dry state than in liquid suspension. I think you cannot generalize this for UV radiation. I only showed the results we have obtained under the conditions I've mentioned before. In other words, I have no clear explanation for this effect so far.
Okay. Thank you.